we're very glad to have Dr. Angham Abdulrazaq. She's born in Mosul, Iraq, and she has a bachelor's degree in the Arabic English translation and master's in English literature from Mosul University. She worked as a translator and a lecturer of comparative literature and world literature in Iraq, Yemen, and Oman. She had her PhD in Women's Studies from the Center for Women's Studies, University of York. And she is a co-translator for a recently published book, which she brought us here as well.
No,
About an Iraqi artist named Don't Unveil My Colors, A Country Sleeps There. The paper she's presenting today is based on her thesis, Contemporary Iraqi Women's Fiction of War, where the writer's experiences of war, her personal experience as a witness and victim of war, and those of the characters in the text she analyzes intermingled to produce an endless story of survival. So now we welcome Dr. Angham.
Thank you very much. And thank you for the IGS department and everybody there, all the organizers, for giving me this really nice chance to present my work and to give voice to all these writers and to find this lovely audience. And thank you very much for everybody for attending. The presentation today is based on my thesis, Contemporary Iraqi Women's Fiction of War. In this work today in the seminar, I'm going to examine selected works by contemporary Iraqi women novelists written during three periods of war, sanctions, and occupation, and its aftermath. I argue that the unceasing chain of wars portrayed in the open-ended narratives I analyze here unsettles mainstream conceptions of women as victims at the home front and men as brave fighters at the battlefront. Instead, women are constructed as survivors, working to preserve the memory of Iraq and its history, gesturing towards a rebirth of Baghdad, or a possible rebirth of Baghdad. I'll take you through some three periods of the decades of wars and sanctions with writers and characters to examine how these writers, their characters, and myself as a researcher shared being eyewitnesses of these three wars and victims also in different types and also survivors, trying to preserve this history that has been falsified by previous governments and also destroyed as a result of these three wars. So before starting, I'll just give you a short overview of the history of the wars in Iraq so that you have an idea how these works are related to each period of war. Contemporary history of wars in Iraq. Maybe most of you know about this. The first war that took place is the Iran-Iraq War. Started in 1980 and ended in 1988. This is regarded as the longest 20th century conventional war. And this war in particular weighed heavily on both sides, the Iraqis and the Iranians, because it took place, as you know, Iran borders Iraq from the eastern part of the country. And we have shared lots of common beliefs and common customs and traditions with Iranian people. And they used to visit us and we used to go and visit their country from time to time. And they used to visit Iraq, the shrines and the religious places. And it was very difficult on both people, as far as I can tell, to have this senseless war. But unfortunately, it took place, and it took 8 years to finish with hundreds and thousands of casualties, prisoners of war, and people who went missing. So, interestingly, while people were still mourning their deaths and they were still trying to expect prisoners of war to come back from the first war after 8 years, Iraq has been indulged in a second war, which is the first Gulf War that started in 1990-1991 with the invasion of Kuwait. And then, as a result, US interfered with 35 countries, allied countries, and they defeated the Iraqi army. But the problem was, it's not only about the defeat of the army, it was about the punishment of the country after that. US and its allies decided to punish Iraqi government by air raids, by raiding the country, and they claimed at the beginning, as usual, to have targeting military installations. But the fact is, these military installations were installed near civilian installations. So you can imagine how the people were punished, how much victims have been as a result of this war. And the infrastructure of the country was mainly targeted. So, and you know what's the meaning of infrastructure. It's everything related to life, electricity, water, all life facilities. So at that time we were completely cut off almost everything. And to increase that punishment, they imposed a 13-year embargo. I don't know if some of you have heard about this, the 13-year sanctions. Again, they claimed at the beginning to sanction military equipment and the materials that are related to weapons and weapons of destruction and all this stuff. But the point is that that embargo was on almost everything in life. I was doing my master's by that time, and I was, like so many other students, I was struggling to try to get articles, books, even papers for writing from any place outside of the borders of the country. So the sanctions were mainly for food, for medicine, anything that occurs to your mind. So we were under these sanctions for 15 years, and then this culminated in the invasion and occupation of Iraq in 2003. This occupation was like the worst that Iraq has ever witnessed. It was not only, again, mainly directed towards overthrowing of the regime of Saddam Hussein, but it was again mainly for the destruction of the whole country, because it was accompanied by a state, an endless state of disarray, of chaos, of destruction of libraries, burning of museums, and looting of the monuments of Iraq, a destruction for 4,000 years of civilization, simply. And as a result of this occupation, the occupation itself opened the doors for extremists to take place, to arise, for militias, for different groups of militias and extremists started to play a role in the country. And women were targeted, and women's situation worsened and worsened as a result of all of this. And this also led, unfortunately, to the existence of the ISIS, getting hold of some cities in Iraq, and then making Mosul the headquarter since 2014 up to this moment. So the works I analyze are organized according to the periods of war during which they were written. So what I am looking at are works written during these periods, with the exception, of course, of the last one. No one could ever dare to write anything under the control of ISIS. There are people who are writing about different parts of the country, and we will discuss this later. So the works I'm looking at are just I will give you a short view of this. texts of the 1980s, Tissam Abdallah's story, Al-Akhar fil Mir'ah, The Other in the Mirror, 1999. This is found in translation, and this is one of the interesting works that I'm looking at because it wasn't found in Iraq, it wasn't published there, it passed censorship of the regime of Saddam Hussein, and luckily I found it with a friend of the writer and was able to just get hold of it and examine it. The other one is Irada Jabouri's story, Astra Prisoners. This work is in Arabic language, and it is here in this book. Again, luckily enough for me that I found this work, the writer was writing silently during Saddam Hussein. She was scared to publish any of these works during that reign because it was against war, against the government. So she had to wait till the fall of the regime in order to be able to publish the work. The period of the 90s, Mr. Nuhani's novella The World Minus One, it's also one of the works that passed the censor despite all the anti-government messages in it, and published in Iraq during the sanctions. It's in Arabic language. And Hadiya Hussein's novel Ma Ba'd al-Hubb, Beyond Love, this is in translation. This author is maybe luckier than the others because she lives in exile and she managed to leave the country and write from there in a freer space. The works of 2003, first one is Iqbal Qazwini's novel, Shubab Zubayda, Zubayda's Window. This is an exile writer who was living in Berlin for, I think, 40 years now, before even these wars. And published from there. The last one is Lutfi Delaney's novel, Sirat Nas wa Medina, Women of Saturn, Biography of People and a City. This is also in Arabic language, sent to me through electronic email. So these are the works that I am going to look at. The following excerpt by one of these writers, Hadiya Hussein, can be used to describe the situation of all writers, to just summarize their attitude towards working in war and under war situation. Hadiya Hussein is one of those writers who witnessed wars during more than three decades. In an interview with myself, she said that war was all that I saw. When I was in Iraq, I knew no other language but that of guns and the black smoke of wars, which I am still breathing. I cannot detach myself from war, and I consider myself a war writer. So this can be an answer for almost the question that is going in anyone's mind, why do they write about war? This is the answer, because they haven't seen anything but war, especially this generation, those people who just grew in the maybe beginning of the 80s or the end of the 70s, like myself, the same time span. So interestingly, maybe most of those writers have been there, eyewitnesses of war. At the same time, I was also there. I was an eyewitness for the first two periods of wars, and I only managed to leave Iraq by the middle of the sanctions, 1994, and then witnessed the occupation and its aftermath from a distance, which makes it even harder, because as you will see from the text that I'm going to discuss, is exile and escape to exile can never be a relief, because it will open more wounds for you. Memory will play a part, and your engagement with watching your country torn apart into a distance, from a distance, will make it even more harder. So there are three reasons why I have chosen these six texts I focus on. First, my concern is with texts critiquing war and dictatorship, which makes it very hard, especially for the texts in the written in the 1980s under the reign of Saddam Hussein and under censorship. So I made this my primary selection criteria, which took me 2 years to get hold of these texts and be able to just look at them through emails from with writers and through connections. It wasn't a very easy job at all to get them. So it took me almost 2 years to try to look for these texts, reach writers through emails, interviewing some of them, and get hold of their work. Second, I based my selection on the fact that these texts addressed a range of traumatic experiences women go through in the context of war. Third, the selection of the majority of the texts I examine stems from my experience as a witness to war and occupation. However, I don't treat these narratives as identical, as each of them tells of a different story and a different trauma. So given the fact that the narratives of the 1980s were state-censored by the Iraqi Ministry of Information, that literature and art during that period were mobilized to serve war propaganda mainly. So works published by the Ministry of Information centered on themes of heroism, martyrdom, as you can expect, and love stories between fighters and women at home. Writers and artists who failed to glorify the war and behave in this manner would be subjected to harsh punishment that could reach to imprisonment and even to exile at some stages. So most texts about the period of the 80s were written by male or about male fighters, honoring the soldiers who sacrificed their lives for the sake of the mother nation. Accordingly, writers who remained in Iraq were divided into four groups. Now mainly I'm focusing on the groups that remained in Iraq during the 80s, and then this led them to take other decisions later. So, writers during the reign of Saddam Hussein, the first group supported the Ba'ath ideology, and if some of you may not, maybe if you don't have an idea what's Ba'ath, Ba'ath a party is the party that represents the government of Saddam Hussein. Ba'ath, the word in Arabic means resurrection, and it's the same party that represents the Syrian government as well, unfortunately. So both of them seem to victimize their people. So the first group supported the Ba'ath ideology out of the culture of violence and because of fear of punishment. The second group expressed their resistance through camouflage. And camouflage is a technique in literature where the writers try to pass their message covered by some figurative language, so that they just pass the censor without being noticed. And some of these works that I am looking at have employed this technique and passed the censor. The third group emigrated as a result of their opposition to the party and to war. And as I said before, this immigration itself opened the door for another dilemma for them, which I mean is not the road was not paved with the glory and the red roses. The fourth group went into an inner exile, and Irad al-Jaburi, as I just show you in this book, is one of those writers who prefer to write secretly and wait for the fall of the regime to publish her work. When I examined Iraqi women's narratives of the period of the 80s, the period which was very censored and glorifying the war and all this stuff, I found that men are not the legendary fighters who daringly go to fight the enemy, and women do not encourage their husbands and sons to seek martyrdom in death. Instead, what I found is that women's texts represent soldiers suffering from physical and psychological wounds which are very hard to heal, and women afflicted by loneliness and desperation. In my analysis of Abdullah's The Other in the Mirror, the first work, which is a state-sponsored text that escaped censorship, I investigate how the writer disguises her text so that it reads like a patriotic story, while presenting a critique of the brutality of the war and the extreme suffering of soldiers and their families. The story tells about a soldier who is newly married to his wife. Then the couple have, I think they just spent 2 years together, and then the war started. And he had to participate in war. As a result of his participation and of the views that he used to see, he became schizophrenic. He started to have this feeling of change in personality. He doesn't know whether he belongs to the war front or to the home front. Whenever he is at home, the only thing that he grabs is a mirror, and that's where the title comes from. And he just looks at the mirror, looks at his reflection, and see a kind of change. The change, of course, is in his inner personality. And this affected his relationship with his wife and ruined that relationship. But of course, the OG was very supportive to him during the whole story. So you may wonder how this message in itself passed unnoticed by the censor. The writer was very clever in just covering her anti-stance towards war and towards this by trying to explain how the woman was suffering and how the man was suffering. So I've just chosen short bits from this story. So this is the female character, and by the way, the female was left unnamed. There is no name for her, no name for the soldier. And this has been done on a purpose, because the writer wants to generalize this suffering so that this could reflect every woman and every soldier. That's how she expresses herself when her husband was away in the war front. I am alone, and it doesn't look like that's going to change anytime soon. I can put up with that. All I have learned these years is how to kill time with silence. It is a profession I began to master after he went to war, or after he was drafted. I slowly fall into sleep. I lull myself with sighs of relief as I repeat for the 100th time, there goes another long day, and tomorrow might bring something else. So the narrative, as you can see, opens in a pervasive atmosphere of dejection. The narrator's description of her gloomy state, which is not going to change anytime soon, this expression itself, not only indicates her depression, but implicitly refers to the prolonged war with no end in sight. Moreover, the wife's use of the word drafted also signifies a veiled condemnation of war where men are enrolled against their will. And to outlive her crisis of survival, the female character achieves an imaginary reunion with her absent husband. In the text, the wife describes how she makes up her own ways of connecting with her absent husband in order to cope up with her situation. I place his teacup on the small table in the kitchen and talk to him. She imagines that he is there. Joke with him or reproach him. Sometimes I even create scenes and quarrel with him. His vacant seat always seemed filled with his presence. So the imaginary presence of the absent husband helps to fill the long days of waiting, but does not bring him back, of course. So this image of the presence, absence of the husband soldier foreshadows his state of change later on in the story, when his physical presence actually turns into a spiritual absence. So when he is physically there, she doesn't feel that he is there because of his psychological problem, because of his connection with the error and nothing but the error. But when he is not there, she feels that he is physically there. It's a very complicated situation which goes on and on till the end of the story when it ends with a complete ruin to this relationship. The other story, Rada Jabouri's Prisoners, is an example of the text written in the 80s but published, as I told you, after the fall of the regime. In the text, and in texts like this text, the acclamatory and heroic discourses which celebrated war as a patriotic duty completely disappears and replaced by a new address that condemns war and its benefactors. So the story centers on Rabab. This is the name of a teacher of Arabic who struggled to survive the death of her husband, killed in war. Her husband was brought to her as a burned, maimed corpse. She was unable to identify the corpse, despite the fact that all the other evidences were there, and his colleagues assured her that this is his corpse and no one else. But she preferred, in order to be able to cope with her situation, she prefers to live in denial. Instead, she tries to think of this corpse as not belonging to her husband. This could be any person, and my husband is in prison. He would be bad later, like so many other stories of families which really happened, and which is common in wartime. People sometimes bury maimed corpses, and then they discover after some time that their loved ones living in imprisonment, and they come back. And then they discover that this corpse belongs to somebody else who is still waiting. So this is the contradiction of war. So this is what she was imagining, because she heard so many of these stories. So maybe he is in prison, imprisoned somewhere, and he will come back to me. And she lived throughout the whole story according to that image. So in order that she cope with it, she prefers to listen to her pupils during the class and their stories. In the meantime, she listens to the tales her pupils bring her about their families, the fathers who disappear in the war, the stories of the horror of death returnees bring back to their wives like birthday presents. The pupils tell her about the long gazes of their mothers at calendars and the red lines their mothers drew under the expected arrival date of their husbands, and how these lines may extend into days and sometimes weeks, leaving the mothers' wives restless. So by listening to the stories of the tragedies and the stories about miseries of others, she finds some relief that she's not alone in this, and there are people who are maybe suffering more than her. So this is how she was coping. During the second half of the 90s, and as a result of the long period of the sanctions following the first Gulf War, the hold of the Iraqi government loosened. This situation offered more space and freedom of speech to writers who describe it and were very bold in portraying the status quo in a way that brought about a type of writing called sanctions books, in Arabic, kutub al-isar. They found some freedom in the censorship of the government to be able to present the human side of the sanctions and how these sanctions led to destruction of life. But at the same time, they were using this freedom in order to pass an anti-war message. And of course, till that time, despite the fact that the government the government power was a bit loose, but still there was censorship, but in a more flexible manner. However, falling between two periods of wars and sanctions, these texts, which are open-ended, reflect the unresolvedness in the Iraqi experience of consecutive wars. The multiplicity of wars has left Iraqis with a sense of their endlessness. The relief at the end of military operations at the battlefront was always mediated by grief over those who were lost. So survivors are thus victimized by their survival, by staying alive, and are destined to suffer for their losses. So the absence of their loved ones opens up wounds that refuse to close. One Iraqi poet, Dunya Milkhai, she is an exiled poet, describes the situation in a very, very short way and in a very powerful manner in her poem Between Two Wars. I have chosen some lines from this poem that can help you imagine the situation. The poem is called Between Two Wars. So this is all that remains, a handful of burnt papers, photos, here and there, with rippled bags like maps. One of us died, another saved his life in his place. Eventually, we forget how, in the short lull between two wars, we became so old. So, in an interview with one of these writers, who was in Iraq during the sanctions, this particular period, she says, writing in wartime is the most difficult task of all. During the 90s, almost all Iraqi women were engaged in how to keep life going with the absence of all facilities that I just told you about. No electricity, no water, no gas, nothing for life. So each one of us, including me of course, had to bake her family's bread, collect wood for baking and cooking from scratch, and maintain her family's safety with the absence of men. These daily activities were time-consuming and were devastating for the mind. How can writers think of writing under such conditions? In 1996, my salary was 3,000 Iraqi dinars, when the price of a dozen of eggs was equal to 3,000 Iraqi dinars. I had to use public transportation as it was cheaper, and whenever I finished writing a part of my work, I used to reward myself with a cup of coffee at one of the coffee shops. So, dire economic situation, scarcity of all life essentials, added to that, sanctions on papers, sanctions on ink for copier machines. You can imagine how, and they were writing, there was production. So one of the writers also describes this situation to me. She said, in the sanctions period, when, for example, one of them wants to publish, no publishing at all. So they try to consult a friend of them or a family relative or somebody who has a hold of copier machines, and they copy and make few copies, and then they distribute them between those who know them here and there, and that's it. So how, I mean, in this situation, no reader would be able to get hold of any of these copies. And that's why any researcher like myself would suffer for ages to get them. Some of them were, I mean, luckily have been published when they went to exile, and some of them are still missing, which is a pity. The other thing is that concerning the papers and sanctions on papers and on pencils for writing, students, university students, they used to write on the backs of receipts, okay, pharmacy bills, account books, anything that has a blank side of it. So this is part of the situation. I remember when I was doing my master's, I used to use any paper, any blank paper possible, and I still keep them, but unfortunately they are in Iraq. I would have really showed them to you. Even sometimes we used to make use of small spaces in the papers here and there just to make use of it, because otherwise you won't find anything. Irada, another writer, left Iraq as a result of the harsh economic situation and lived in Yemen. As a result of what I was telling you about the sanctions and all the hardships, most of these writers had to choose to leave. And luckily, the only Arab country that that used to give us visas, give Iraqis visa, entrance visa, was Yemen. And no Arab other Arab country offered us visa. And also, I think, at some stage, Libya also. So, Irad al-Jabouri went to Yemen, just for of course, for economic reasons, and stayed there for 4 years. And this is how she describes her experience in Yemen. Leaving Iraq was my biggest mistake. I was haunted by the image of Iraq and was thinking of it as a sick child that I had left. I did not have my own library or my own garden in Yemen. My experience there was rich with pain. I was like a thread out of a silk fabric, which stays in the air and can neither fly away nor get back to mingle with the fabric again. This is one hard experience after which Irada decided to return to Iraq despite all these hardships, and she is still there, lecturing at the Media Studies Department, University of Baghdad. And most of her works published, I think she managed to publish online, again with all these difficulties of publishing. So the other text, which is Beyond Love, written in the 90s by exile writer Hadiya Hussein, who escaped an assassination attempt by the regime as a result of her opposition to the ruling party and war. In her exile in Canada, the writer enjoys the freedom of uncovering the brutality of the Ba'ath regime in punishing its opponents. In the text, the writer mocks the false democracy represented in the forged elections in the country. This is how she describes the elections. They made us crawl to the polls to write just one word, yes. We were to write it in support of a president who had no rival. When I told him my idea, my cousin assured me that even if the entire people said no, the result would be indisputably yes. Nevertheless, I was stubborn and I wrote no. So, in one way or another, this describes the writer's position as well. She herself, Hadiya Hussein, was so stubborn, and she was having this anti-government stance in her interviews and in her writing, and that's why she was targeted and was about to get assassinated by the Iraqi regime, but she managed to flee Iraq. She first lived in Jordan for some time and then to Canada. Also interestingly, when I was contacting her just to have an idea about the works that she was publishing and where can I find them, she said, I just got my visa to Canada and I have packed all my books and put them, placed them in one of her friends in Jordan. She did not get any of these books until a year later in Canada, and then I got one of them. Really lucky. So back to the elections thing that she is describing here. This is just part of her novel Beyond Love, which is full of expressions of the brutality of the regime and how the regime used to punish people, the opponents, especially the people in prison and all this. So, and it's a fact about the elections, by the way. Saddam Hussein used to win 99.9% in every and each election, and in 2002 he won 100% votes. And when a TV interviewer, I can't remember from which country, happened to ask him, how come? He said, well, people love me. I can't interfere. And only when that 99.9% took place, it was my vote that was missing. So this is the explanation, which is typical of Saddam Hussein, and also typical of Syria. I'm pointing to Syria because we have someone from Syria here, a friend of mine, and he knows exactly what I am talking about. Yeah, so the same situation, the same party, the same dilemma. So now, if we compare Irada's experience in exile with Hediye Hussein's experience in exile, we will see that she has a different different opinion. There's no slide here, sorry. Hediye Hussein says, I left Iraq in 1999, but I continue writing about the world that ruined Iraq and deformed its beauty. In exile, I have become closer to my country because I enjoy a sense of freedom of expression. I wrote about the previous wars, dictatorship, militarization of life, the men who disappear in the underground cells, and the hidden crimes of the regime. Now, quickly, I will go to 2003, because this is very important. In 2003, there is a different challenge, and a new challenge that faced Iraqi women writers and Iraqis all over the country. With the existence of militias, sectarian groups, and extremists. The Iraqi writer Lutfiya Duleymi describes her daily life in Baghdad after 2003, before leaving the country. This is one of the established writers who could not manage to leave. She tried to apply for visa here and there, European countries and other countries, but she couldn't. So she preferred to stay, but then managed maybe after this to go to Jordan. So this is how she describes her life during the occupation. When electricity is cut, I light a candle and take the risk to go out to the garden to start the generator, while shivering for fear of a thief or a killer lurking in the darkness among the trees. When the generator is on, it's almost 3 a.m. and I can't go back to sleep. I sit at my desk to rewrite some paragraphs from my novel. I write few pages and get drowsy again. I sleep on the big sofa in my study after shoving it away from the window to escape any possible shootings in the New Street. This writer herself was targeted because she was editor-in-chief of a very important woman journal in Baghdad, and also because she was unveiled. So she had to leave Iraq by the end, I think, 2007. In her novel, Women of Saturn, Hayat, the central character and narrator, tells the story of Baghdad's survival. And in this novel, the writer tries to use the basement in her parents' house as a means of protection, and also as a means of discovering the history of Iraq, because she found chronicles written by her uncle in the basement. And this is the case, by the way, for almost all Iraqis. We use basements during wartime to protect us and also to provide us with very cool kind of feeling during summer because of the electricity cut and shortcuts. So she invites six of her friends, her women friends, to gather with her in the basement, and each of these women gave her or tell her a story of either abduction, of targeting, of a loss of a son, or a loss of a husband. She adds these stories together with the stories of Baghdad and its history, and tries to form another story about the survival of Baghdad through ages of destruction, because as you've heard or maybe know that Baghdad and Iraq has been through ages and ages of destruction and ruin, and this is not new for us. But every time Baghdad survives, and the novel gives us this indication that there is a possible rebirth of Baghdad one day. In her novel also, she talks about the honor killing and how, as a result of, if you remember the famous Abu Ghraib, prison, and how the U.S. Used to rape men and women. So one of the women characters, her name is Hara, was raped in Abu Ghraib prison. And interestingly, her family was chasing her because she dishonored the family. So in the novel, the writer tries to mock this ritual of honor killing or this practice, but she attributes it to the social. She attributes this social injustice to the disarray that is happening in the country. In spite of the fact that writers of war discuss social injustice against women in their texts, they don't consider social injustice the main reason behind women's misfortune, as propagated by US claiming to bring democracy and to liberate Iraqi women. In women's war texts, the political system is blamed for oppressing women and for using them to serve the war agenda. I want to just rush, excuse me, because I'm missing some parts. I just want to present you with just two and then we'll end. Now, about me. My memory of the war events is, in this situation, a kind of text. Although I cannot totally rely on my memory for the figures and exact dates of events, but my recollections do give me a specific insider perspective on the events. For example, when I first read one of the novellas, Hadi's The World Minus One, which represents the effect of the loss of the only son on the lives of his parents, I identified with the text as it portrays the events of the loss of my family and my cousin. The father's way of complicating his son's picture on the wall in the novel, while losing contact with his wife, resembled my uncle's way of staring at his dead son's picture on the wall for hours. The representation of the ongoing agony of survival of the parents in the novella is very similar to the slow death my relatives went through 4 years, leading eventually to their actual death after their only son. So witnessing this shared grief enables me, in Hartman's word, to read the wound of these characters. So reading the wound engenders sympathy with the victims. It also places me as a helpless onlooker, because when I am witnessing these and unable to do anything, it paralyzes me as well. So in one of the novels, Zubaydah's Window, the character Zubaydah, the main character Zubaydah, who represents the writer, the exiled writer in Berlin, while watching the bombing of Iraq on her TV from her flat in Berlin, this is how she describes it. It seems to Zubaydah that the whole world has gathered in Iraq, that nothing exists outside its borders. Pictures of death unroll on the TV screen as she watches, feeling confused about whether she should continue watching. She feels rather dizzy, her breathing becomes increasingly irregular. So this is the same situation that I also went through when I was watching the destruction of my country from afar in 2003, and also again in 2014 when ISIS controlled Mosul. So hearing the news about the bombing of my city Mosul in 2003 when I was in Jordan cost me long nights of fear and angst. I could not help but identify with Zubaydah while watching the flames of fire engulfing Baghdad from her TV. Lost in reverie, she sees only the heavy fire on all fronts of Iraq. Why did she leave her home in flames? Could she have helped put out the fires? So I was also overcome by a sense of guilt for being far, being safe, and just watching. So being physically absent from the scene of violence gave me a sense of estrangement. The paradox in my situation lies in the fact that my sense of guilt in not being there, in not physically sharing all of the words, or I mean the last two words, became a perpetual moral sharing of the suffering of my people. This idea is expressed by one of the writers who an exiled writer who also feels and thinks that it's the responsibility of all writers to talk about this and to register and give a record of what is happening, because unfortunately this history has been first maimed and falsified by the previous government of Saddam Hussein for the, to serve the purpose of war and for the war propaganda. And then it was maimed and burned by the occupiers, and now maimed more by ISIS. So it's the job of us, researchers, writers, as much as we can, to give a record for the future generation. And to end with the last paragraph. Although the central female characters are constructed as traumatized in consequence to what happens to them and their loved ones, the war does not ultimately break them. The crisis of their survival turns into a possibility of survival. This goes for the writers and for the characters. So the isolation and despair they go through as a result of their losses, of their fear, of exile and estrangement, all these dilemmas that they went through, strengthen their will to survive. This is embodied in the effort to find meaning in their existence amid the madness of war. In most cases, this meaning is articulated through the act of telling and of writing, which becomes an equivalent to survival. So, and this is described by the central character of the last novel, Hayat, who continues writing Baghdad on her palm as the city has turned into a tiny word and words don't die. Thank you very much.
Mm-hmm.